ஆழ்வார் திருவடிகளே சரணம், எம்பெருமானார் திருவடிகளே சரணம், பிள்ளைலோக்காச்சாரியர் திருவடிகளே சரணம், ஜீயர் திருவடிகளே சரணம், ஜீயர் திருவடிகளே சரணம், பிள்ளைலோக்காச்சாரியர்ஸ் முமுக்ஷுப்படி இஸ் தி மோஸ்ட் ஃபவுண்டேஷனல் கிரந்தம் ஃபார் ஸ்ரீ வைஷ்ணவாஸ். ஆல் ஸ்ரீ வைஷ்ணவாஸ் மஸ்ட் லேர்ன் திஸ் கிரந்தம் வித் இட்ஸ் மீனிங்ஸ், பிகாஸ் In this Grantham, Pillalokacharya has brought out the deep meanings of Rahasya Trayam in the most comprehensive way. Rahasya Trayam must be known by all Sri Vaishnavas who undergo Pancha Samskaram. Acharya first gives Mantropadesham. After that, he also gives the meanings for the mantrams, for the Rahasya Trayam. Knowing this Rahasya Trayam, understanding the important principles, we can arrange our life accordingly as per the words of our Purvacharyas. In this Mumukshupadi, we have three sections: Tirumantra Prakaranam, Doya Prakaranam, and Charma Shloka Prakaranam. We have seen Tirumantra Prakaranam and Doya Prakaranam. Now we are starting to see Charma Shloka Prakaranam. We saw the introduction and the first sutram yesterday. In the introduction, Manavada Mamnihal beautifully narrated how Bhagavad Ramanuja went to Tirukoshtiyur to get the meaning for this Charma Shlokam, and how Tirukoshtiyur Nambi gave the name Emperumanar to Bhagavad Ramanuja after Bhagavad Ramanuja revealing the secret meanings of Charma Shlokam to those who were eager to know about it in a secluded place in the Tirukoshtiyur temple. It was explained there that the Acharyas before Bhagavad Ramanuja, they were cautious about not revealing this meaning to anyone other than those who are very, very sincere, very dedicated, very faithful towards Shastram and Bhagavan. Seeing the greatness of the Charma Shlokam and its meaning, but Bhagavad Ramanuja, seeing the pathetic state of Jivatmas in this Kali Yuga, he mercifully revealed the meanings of Charma Shlokam to those who were eager to know about it. Following his footsteps, Pillalokacharya mercifully documented the meanings of Charma Shlokam as part of this Mumukshupadi and gave it to the whole community so that everyone can understand these meanings easily and become uplifted. And in the first sutram, 185th sutram, first sutram of this prakaranam, 185th sutram in the grantham, Pillalokacharya explained why this particular shlokam in Bhagavad Gita got the name Charma Shlokam. That is because Bhagavan Krishna, after explaining all the different upayams, different ways, means for liberation, such as Karma Yogam, Jnana Yogam, Bhakti Yogam, and so on, finally he revealed this ultimate goal of Sharanagati. And hence, this Charma Shlokam, where Bhagavan revealed this ultimate means, becomes to be known as Charma Shlokam. That is why this Shlokam is known as Charma Shlokam. We have seen the first sutram. Now we will continue on from 186th sutram. We are going through the beautiful grantham of Mumukshupadi with the help of Manavada Mamnigal's beautiful commentary. Let us see 186th sutram. Manavada Mamnigal gives an introduction here. Now, in this sutram, Pillalokacharya is mercifully giving vakyartham, the full meaning of the whole shlokam in this particular sutram, starting with idil purvardhathale. Let us see the sutram, 186th sutram. இதில் பூர்வார்த்தத்தாலே அதிகாரி கிருத்தியத்தை அருளி செய்கிறான், உத்தரார்த்தத்தாலே உபாய கிருத்தியத்தை அருளி செய்கிறான். சிம்பிள் மீனிங் ஃபார் திஸ் சூத்திரம் இஸ் பகவான் இஸ் எக்ஸ்பிளைனிங் தி டியூட்டி ஆஃப் தி ஜீவாத்மா இன் தி ஃபர்ஸ்ட் ஹாஃப் ஆஃப் தி ஸ்லோகம். தி ஸ்லோகம் ஹேஸ் டூ ஹாஃப்ஸ். இன் தி ஃபர்ஸ்ட் ஹாஃப் தி ஜீவாத்மாஸ் ரெஸ்பான்சிபிலிட்டி ஆர் டியூட்டி is highlighted by Bhagavan. In the Uttarardham, in the second half, Bhagavan is talking about his responsibility, Bhagavan's responsibility or Bhagavan's duty, Bhagavan's activity, that is mercifully explained by Bhagavan in the second half of the shlokam. So in the two halves, the duty of the individual Atma, and in the second half, the duty of the Paramatma, Bhagavan, is highlighted. That is the simple meaning. Let us see Mamnigal's commentary. So there are two halves in this particular shlokam, Charma shlokam, in Gita Charma shlokam. In the first half, whatever the Jivatma, the qualified personality, individual, he has to do, that is mercifully highlighted by Bhagavan. That is Sarvadharman Parityajya Mamyekam Sharanam Raja. That highlights what the Jivatma needs to do. And then in the Uttarardham, in the second half, Bhagavan, who is the Upaya Bhuta, Bhagavan is the Upayam, Bhagavan is the means. And for the Jivatma who surrendered, what is the response given by Bhagavan? What is the activity done by Bhagavan? That is highlighted in the second half. So that is the explanation given in Mamnigal in the commentary for 186th Sutram. Now 187th Sutram, Mamnigal is giving the introduction here. There is a question. Okay, what is the duty of the Jivatma, the qualified person who is surrendering to Bhagavan? What is his duty? So that is explained in the 187th Sutram, saying Adhikarikku Krityamavadu Upaya Parigraham. Adhikari means the qualified person here. Qualified person means one who is ready to perform surrender. That person's duty is highlighted in this sutram, 187th sutram. Okay, 187th sutram. இஸ் அதிகாரி கிருத்தியமாவது உபாய பரிகிரகம். தட் இஸ் 187th சூத்திரம். ஓகே, ஸோ 187th சூத்திரம், அதிகாரிக்கு கிருத்தியமாவது உபாய பரிகிரகம், தட் இஸ் for the qualified person who is ready to surrender, what is that he has to do? Upaya parigraham. He has to pursue Bhagavan as the means. That is the duty, that is the activity to be done by the qualified person who is ready to surrender. Same thing is explained by Mamnigal in the commentary also. Adhikari, that is a qualified person who is surrendering, for him, all he has to do is, he has to accept that Bhagavan is the Upayam. That is 187th Sutram. Now 188th Sutram, there is a question here. Because in the first line, first part of the shlokam, there is Sarvadharman Parityajya Mamyekam Sharanam Raja. Though Mamyekam Sharanam Raja is there, which is the Upaya Parigraham, there is also before that Sarvadharman Parityajya. So the question here is, instead of just saying accept Bhagavan as the means, why is the giving up of other upayams. Other means that is highlighted here. That is the question. For that, the answer is given in 188th Sutram. Attai Sangamaga Vidikiran. That is, he is ordering the Jivatma to surrender, but while doing that, he is saying, do it along with these particular limbs. Angam means limbs. That is prerequisites. Whatever we have to do before doing particular activity. So that limbs are highlighted here by Bhagavan while ordering the Atma to surrender. Atma to accept Bhagavan as the means. So let us see Mom Nigal's commentary here. So Upaya Svikaram is Mamekam Sharanam Raja. That is the Upaya Svikaram portion. That is, the Jivatma should accept Bhagavan as the Upayam. That is the actual Upaya Svikaram. But along with that, there is a prerequisite which is identified by Bhagavan. That is Sarva Dharman Parityajya. Because they are prerequisites. Giving up other means is a prerequisite to surrendering to Bhagavan. Mom Nigal is giving a beautiful example here. The example is Prakshalya Padha Vachamet Snatva Vidivadarchayet Titvargyam Banave Dadyat Dhyatva Devam Japen Manum. So, this is a beautiful Pramanam. Here the example is explained by Mom Nigal himself in the commentary. Before we perform Achamanam, and before we do that, we have to wash our hands and legs. Then only we have to do Achamanam. So for performing Achamanam, washing the hands and legs are precondition, prerequisite. Similarly, Snatva Vidivarchayet. Vidivadarchayet. Before we perform puja, Tiruvaradhanam, we have to take baths. So, bathing is a prerequisite. Without bathing, we cannot do Tiruvaradhanam. Similarly, when we do argyam, when we give argyam, at that time, we have to be standing and then giving. So, that is the prerequisite. We have to be standing before giving argyam. We cannot do it in a sitting posture. Similarly, when we meditate upon, when we recite a mantra, when we chant a mantra, we have to meditate upon the particular devata for that mantra. So these are all highlighted as limbs or prerequisites for performing certain actions. Similarly, for upaya parigraham, for pursuing Bhagavan as the upayam, this particular giving up of other upayams, that has to be done. Then only we can pursue Bhagavan as the upayam. So, by giving this example, Mom Nigal says, just as it is explained here that there are so many prerequisites for so many different actions in Vaidik Dharma, similarly, even for surrender, pursuing Bhagavan as the upayam, we have to give up other upayams. So, that is a mandatory prerequisite. Here, Mom Nigal explains, because of this, there are some who say that some are unable to do, some are incapable to do actions such as pursue the means such as Karma Yogam, Jnana Yogam, Bhakti Yogam and so on. So for them, they can give up, for those who are incapable, they can give up these upayams and pursue Bhagavan. For those who are capable of doing Bhakti Yogam, let them do Bhakti Yogam. There are some who say that. But by saying Sarva Dharman Parityajya, Bhagavan is clearly rejecting such notions. Bhagavan is saying that whether you are capable or incapable, whether you are able to do other means or not, once you have that mindset that Bhagavan is everything, you have to give up attachment to all other upayams and pursue Bhagavan as the only upayam. That is a rule. So here, it is not that if I am capable, I can do. If I am incapable, I will not do. We cannot consider like that. This is with reference to other upayams. So if I am able to do Bhakti Yogam, then I will do Bhakti Yogam. If I am not able to do Bhakti Yogam, I will do Sharanagati. That is not the accepted notion by Bhagavan here. Bhagavan is clearly saying that for surrender, for those who are in that stage of surrendering, they have to give up attachment to all other upayams. They cannot be pursuing any of the upayams. So that is also clearly highlighted by Mamnigal here, saying that Bhagavan's wish is one should only perform surrender, because it is natural to the Jivatma's quality. Being a servitor, being in that state of Paratantriyam, surrender is a natural act. Accepting Bhagavan as the Upayam is the natural means for the Jivatma. So that is established in this particular sutram. Now, 189th sutram, there is a question here. Now, why should it be ordered by Bhagavan? Anyway, we saw that Bhakti Yogam or all other means, whatever other upayams, they are all difficult to perform. So even if someone is greatly capable, even if they can do Bhakti Yogam, they have to give up Bhakti Yogam and they have to perform Sharanagati. But there is a notion that other upayams are difficult to perform because they have to be performed over many lifetimes. They have to be supported by heavy penances, controlling the senses and so on and so forth. So, we understand that Sharanagati is very easy to perform. It is just the act of accepting Bhagavan as the means. So, when we accept, when it is so easy to perform, why should it be ordered? That is the question here. When this is really desirable, when this is really easy for everyone to do, why is it ordered? If something is easy, will they not naturally do it? Why it should be ordered? That is the question here. For that, Pillalokacharya is answering in 189th Sutram, Raga Praptamana Upayam Tane Vaidamanal Kaduga Parigrahikaiki Udalai Irikumire. So, Raga Praptam means that which is very desirable, that which is very, very practically possible for us to do and very easy for us to do. For such Upayam, here Bhagavan is the Upayam, and accepting Bhagavan as Upayam is very easy to do. Now, when that becomes the rule also, then it facilitates easy pursuit of that same means. That is the simple meaning for this sutram. Mamnigal gives a very beautiful example which we will easily understand. So here, an example is given by Mamnigal in the commentary. For example, one has indigestion. Digestion problem is there for a particular person. For such person, he already likes milk. He really likes milk. If the doctor prescribes, okay, drink 3 glasses of milk and your indigestion will be resolved. You will be cured of indigestion. Then that patient will happily drink that milk because he already likes milk. And there is also an order by the doctor saying that there is a prescription saying that you drink milk for your indigestion, and then that indigestion is also cured. So he will pursue it joyfully. Similarly, when the particular means, that is this upayam, this particular means which is Sharanagati, accepting Bhagavan as the means, when that is very easy to do, and when Shastram orders it and when Bhagavan orders it, then it is very easy for the individual to pursue that particular means. Hence, it is ordered by Bhagavan here. So that is the explanation given by Mohamnigal here. So Bhagavan orders so that it's already easy to do, and the Jivatma will be double joyful. Twice the joy will be acquired by Jivatma, because it is very easy to perform as well as it is being ordered by Bhagavan also. So that is explained in this 189th Sutram. Now 190th Sutram. From this Sutram, Mamnigal highlights in the introduction that Pillilokacharya starts explaining the Charma Shlokam word by word. So in 190th Sutram, he says, Pillilokacharya says, Idil Purvardham Arupadham. Purvardham means, Ardham means half. So in this Sutram, Pillilokacharya is saying, Idil, in this Charma Shlokam, the Purvardham, the first part, first half, it has six words. 191st Sutram, he starts, Pillilokacharya starts mercifully explaining each word of it, and the first word is Sarvadharman. So that is the 191st Sutram, Sarvadharman, Illa Dharmangalayum. So Illa Dharmangalayum means all dharmas. Now he is going to explain what this is in the subsequent sutrams. So 192nd Sutram, Mamnigal gives an introduction. Now this Sarvadharman, if you look at the word, if you look at the word Sarvadharman, it has multiple portions. There is Sarva, Dharma and Dharman. Sarva is all, we know. Dharma is, it's going to be explained what it is. And then there is Dharman, which is plural for Dharma. So these three portions are going to be explained by Pillilokacharya. First he starts with what is Dharma. The word Dharma is first explained. 192nd Sutram. Dharmamavadu palasadhanamai irukkumadu. So he is explaining here, dharmam means that which is means for a particular goal, particular end, particular result. So that is the meaning for dharmam. Now he is going to further explain that in the 193rd Sutram. So this dharma, the word dharma, it can be a means to attain any goal. It can be a goal which is visible. That is, whatever we see in this world, that is wealth, family, health and so on. Any of those could be result for dharma. Dharma is just a means to get a particular result. So here he clarifies in this sutram, Pillilokacharya is clarifying that this dharma is focusing on moksha phalam, not worldly benefits. This is not focusing on worldly benefits, but the benefit of liberation. Because that is the context here. Bhagavan is giving all this knowledge to Arjuna so that he will be free from samsara. The whole purpose of teaching karma yoga, jnana yoga, bhakti yoga, all of that is to ultimately reach Bhagavan. So here in this particular Charma Shlokam, the context of dharma is for moksha. That is the goal here. So that is what is explained in this 193rd Sutram. Ingu chollugira dharma shabdham. Drishta pala sadhanangalai chollugai andrike moksha pala sadhanangalai chollugirathu. Drishta palam. Drishta palam means visible results. Sadhanam means it's a way, it's a process. So instead of highlighting this dharma, the word dharma here, instead of highlighting the means to get worldly pleasures or worldly benefits which are visible to us, instead of saying that, this particular shabdam, dharmam, is focusing on moksha pala sadhanam. Moksha pala sadhanam means the goal of attaining liberation. That is explained in this word dharma. Pillalokacharya has wonderfully given the meaning for Charma Shlokam. Not only Charma Shlokam, from Tirumantram and Dwayam also we have seen the same thing. He breaks the whole sentence into multiple parts. Each part he is explaining in great detail. And of course with Manavar Mamnigal's commentary, we can understand the full depth of these principles. So, here he is saying that it is focusing on Mokshapala Sadhanam. That is the process which focuses on the result of Moksham. Let us see Mamnigal's commentary. Here, even while explaining Karma Yogam, Jnana Yogam, Bhakti Yogam, there are all of those means, all of those processes are going to be highlighted subsequently. In any of those processes, the goal is ultimately liberation. So, the context here of Bhagavad Gita is fully focused on knowledge about Atma. What is the ultimate goal of Atma? That is liberation, and how to achieve that liberation through various processes, whether it is Karma Yogam, Jnana Yogam, Bhakti Yogam, or whatever it is. So, because this Gita, though it was set up in the battlefield and it was aimed at motivating Arjuna to fight the battle, but the underlying principle is he has to understand what his role is and act according to that role. So that is why Bhagavan was instructing about the role and the nature of Atma, the nature of Karma, the nature of Karma Yoga, Jnana Yoga, Bhakti Yoga, Purushottama Vidya, Avatara Rahasyam, all of these are explained by Bhagavan. So throughout the Gita, the context is liberation. So naturally, the culminating shlokam, the Charma shlokam, that will also be focusing on Moksham only. Hence, it is not talking about the worldly goals such as having good family, having wealth, having land, having properties, having nice healthy life and so on. This is not the goal of Bhagavad Gita itself. Bhagavad Gita itself is focused on Moksham. So obviously the essence of Bhagavad Gita, which is Charma Shlokam, that will be also focused on Moksham only. So that is here highlighted. So Dharmam means Moksha Pala Sadhanam. So that is established here. Now, there is 194th Sutram. Mamunigal gives introduction. Now there is Bahuvachanam. That is, Dharma is said as Dharman. That means it is plural. More than two. In Sanskritam, there is Ekavachanam, Dvivachanam, Bahuvachanam. When it is Ekavachanam, it is single. Dvivachanam means it is double. And anything more than two, it is Bahuvachanam. So here, when Bhagavan Krishna says Dharman, that means there are many, many Upayams. And that is highlighted in this 194th Sutram. Avaidan Shruti Smriti Vihidangalai Palava Yirikayale Bahuvachana Prayogam Pandigrathu. So Bhagavan here is using Bahuvachanam, the usage of plural, to say Dharma. So he is saying Dharman, that means they are many. And why they are many? Because in Shruti and Smriti they are ordered, and there are many which are highlighted in Shruti and Smriti. Shruti means Vedam, Smriti means all the ancillary subjects, all the ancillary Shastram. So in both Shruti and Smriti, these dharmams are ordered, and they are many in number. So because of that, Bhagavan is using Bahuvachanam. Because of that, he is here using Dharman. So here, Mamnigal's commentary, the Mokshapala Sadhanas, the means to attain Moksham, are identified in Shruti and Smriti. Shruti is known as Upabhramhya. Smriti is known as Upabhramana. Upabhramhya means the main concepts, the principles. Upabhramana means they are expanded. The main concepts are expanded in Smriti. Shruti is the source. and what is explained in source is elaborated in Smriti. So both of these are highlighting multiple means to attain moksham. And hence, Bhagavan is using the term Dharman. So we have to understand, even Bhagavan is following what is given in Shastram. Bhagavan is not independently advising anything. He is also following Shastram. So everybody is following Shastram. That is the importance of Shastram is highlighted here. So because Shruti and Smriti show multiple means for moksham, Bhagavan is saying that it is Dharman. There are many means. Now, what are those dharmams? They are highlighted in the subsequent sutram, that is 195th sutram by Pillilokacharya. Avayavana karmajnana bhakti yogangalum avatara rahasya jnanam purushottama vidyai deshavasam tirunama sankirtanam tiruvilakkerikkai திருமாலை எடுக்கை தொடக்கமான உபாய புத்தியா செய்யும் அவையும். So here in this sutram, Pillilokacharya is saying what are all the other means. So now we have two categories. One is Bhagavan as the upayam, and then there are other upayams, other means to attain liberation. Now what are those other means? We understand that Bhagavan is the means for us, for mumukshus, for Sharanagatas. But for others, because Vedam is meant for all kinds of people, whether one is a self-centered person who firmly believes that I have to accomplish my target, myself. For such person also, Vedam is showing the means. So we are going to see that actually why Vedam is showing multiple upayams, that is also going to be explained further. But here we can see that there are multiple means and they are karma jnana bhakti yogangalum. So karma jnana bhakti yogas, these three yogams which are very popular, everyone knows, and we have seen about karma yogam, jnana yogam, bhakti yogam, all of these we have seen about this in Artha Panchakam. When we saw Artha Panchakam, we saw the upayam. In that upayam, there are five types of upayam are shown. Among those, karma, jnana, bhakti were explained. So, karma yogam, jnana yogam, bhakti yogam, they are identified here. Mamnigal is going to explain further. We will see in the commentary. First, we will see the simple example. So, karma, jnana, bhakti yogam, they are present. And then, avatara rahasya jnanam, the knowledge, the true knowledge about Bhagavan's incarnations. So that is the next means. These are all means to attain liberation. Purushottama Vidya. Purushottama Vidya means knowledge about Bhagavan. How, what is his nature? What are his qualities? What are his various forms? So all of these are covered until under Purushottama Vidya. And then Deshavasam. One can reside in Dividesams, Punyakshetrams and attain liberation with that firm belief. And then Tirunama Sankirtanam. Nama Sankirtanam, this is very well known. Everybody knows that Nama Sankirtanam is a means to reach Bhagavan. Tiruvilakkerikkai, that is lighting lamps in temples. Doing that as a particular means, one can attain moksham. These are again shown in Shastram. Tirumala Edukkai. Tirumala Edukkai means making garlands and offering that to Bhagavan. So any of these activities, when done with the upaya buddhi, upaya buddhi means doing these, considering them as upayam. Because the reason why upaya buddhya is highlighted here is even Sharanagata is going to do all of these. He is going to be engaged in Kaikariyam, he is going to be engaged in knowing about Bhagavan, he is going to be living in a Dividesham, he is going to be engaged in Nama Sankirtanam, he is going to be lighting lamps in temple, he is going to be making garlands in temple. So even Mukshu, even Sharanagata will be doing this. But he is not doing with the thought of Upaya Buddhi. He is not considering them as Upayam, but instead he is considering them as Kaikaryam. to Bhagavan. He is doing that for the pleasure of Bhagavan. So the key word here is upaya buddhya. Here, when it is said that upaya buddhya, that is the main word here, because when these are done with the concept of upayam, sadhanam, then they are all coming under the dharman word. Dharman means dharmams, plural. That includes all of these upayams. So that is explained in this sutram. Let us see Mam Nigal's commentary. He is giving examples and quotes for every one of these upayams which are highlighted by Palayalokacharya. That is, for example, in Bhagavad Gita himself, Bhagavan says, Karmanaivahi samsiddhim astita janakadayaha tasmadasaktas satatam karyam karma samachara. So here Janaka Maharaja is identified as a Karma Yoga Nishta. He performed Karma Yoga and attained liberation. And then, Sarvam Karmakilam Partha Jnane Parisamapyate Nahi Jnane Na Sadrusham Pavitramiha Vidyate Jnanagni Sarva Karmani Basmasad Kurute Tatha. All of these refer to Jnana Yogam being identified as means by Bhagavan. So Bhagavan himself has identified all of these in Bhagavad Gita in the initial adhyayams. In the first few chapters, he identified these, in the first six chapters, he identifies Karma Yogam and Jnana Yogam in great detail. And then subsequently, he talks about Bhakti Yogam also. In Bhakti Yogam, he says, Bhaktya Tvananya Shakyaha Man Manabhava Madbhaktaha Madhyaji Mam Namaskuru. All of these shlokams relate to, and these chapters also relate to Bhakti Yogam being means. So Palayalokacharya is highlighting, Mam Nigal is highlighting based on Palayalokacharya's words. He is quoting from various pramanams, from Bhagavad Gita, from Shastram, Vedam, from Upanishads. He is quoting all of these to highlight that there are so many of these which are considered as upayams, sadhanams. And then Avatara Rahasyam. So that is highlighted in 4th chapter. Janma Karma Chamaya Divyam Evam Yo Veti Tattvataha Tyaktva Deham Punar Janma Naiti Mameti Sorjuna. So Bhagavan is saying, those who have full understanding about my birth and my activities, they don't return to samsaram. They come to me. And then that is Avatara Rahasya Jnanam. And then he is talking about Purushottama Vidya. In 15th chapter, fully Purushottama Vidya is explained by Bhagavan. Yetad Buddhva Buddhiman Syat Kritakrityascha Bharata. So, those who are fully having full understanding about Bhagavan's aspects, they are considered to be one who has done everything which is to be done for attaining liberation. So, Purushottama Vidyai. And then Deshoyam Sarvakama Dukhe. This is a pramanam which explains that those who are residing in Dividesham's, they will be liberated. So that is about Dividesha Vasam. And then we all know about Trinama Sankirtanam. Sarva Papa Vishuddhatma Yati Brahma Sanatanam. This Trinama Sankirtanam, this Nama Sankirtanam is considered as remover of all sins and will grant liberation also. That is Trinama Sankirtanam. And then Kritena Vata Tailena Deepam Yo Jwalayen Naraha Vishnave Vidivati Bhaktya Tasya Punya Palam Shrunu Vihaya Sakalam Papam Sahasraditya Sannibaha Jyotishmata Vimane Na Vishnuloke Mahiyate. One who is engaged in lighting lamps in the temples of Bhagavan with oil or ghee for the sake of Bhagavan Vishnu, for his joy, for such person, he will be acquiring great radiance and he will ascend to Vishnulokam in a very bright and radiant vehicle, says This is from Narasimha Puranam. So in this manner, there are many of these upayams are highlighted. So all of these, similarly, Tirumalayadikai, making garlands and submitting to Bhagavan for his pleasure, that is also highlighted as a means. So highlighting all of these pramanams, Manavan Mamnigal says that any of these activities, when performed as upayam, that is a very important point to remember, already we spoke about it. When done as kaikaryam, that is different. All the mumukshus will engage in all of these activities as kaikaryam only. We will never consider that I do this lighting of lamp in your temple and you please give moksham for me. We never ask for that. I do namasankirtanam, you liberate me from this world or you eliminate my sins. We never ask that. Those will be whatever results we get, we will naturally get that. But we will never ask for it, we will never expect that also. So, but when they are done as a particular upayam, they will lead to moksham. Now, there is no guarantee that it will happen in one life, because that is the difference between Sharanagati and all other upayams. Sharanagati guarantees that one gets liberated at the end of this body itself. All other upayams, it may take many, many lifetimes. That is also a difference. But here, they are all explained as the meaning for dharman, all of the upayams. So that is 195th sutram. So with this, Pillalokacharya has explained dharma and dharman, and Mamnigal has given the commentary for that. Now 196th sutram, there is also sarva. Sarva is the prefix here. So this prefix has some particular meaning. Already dharman means plural. So what is the point in saying sarva here? That is explained in this 196th sutram. Now Pillalokacharya is explaining the meaning for sarva shabdam, starting with sarva shabda tale. Sutram sarva shabda tale avvava sadhana visheshangalai anushtikkum idathil avatrukku போக்யதா பாதகங்களான நித்திய கர்மங்களை சொல்லுகிறது. So in this sutram, sarva means whatever sadhanam. Sadhanam means the upayam, the process. In engaging in that particular sadhanam, there will be prerequisites which are required before we engage in particular yoga or particular means. We saw before, right? Before doing achamanam, one has to do washing of legs and hands. So that is a prerequisite. Similarly, for every one of these, karma yogam, jnana yogam, bhakti yogam, nama sankirtanam, for every one of these, there are prerequisites which are expected to be done. So that particular aspect is highlighted by sarva. That is the explanation, simple explanation for 196th sutram. So this is the, without the limbs, without the prerequisites, one cannot even engage in the particular yogam or particular upayam. So those are also highlighted in this sarva dharman. In the sarva word, that is, those are highlighted here. Let us see Mamnigal's explanation. He gives example again, which will facilitate us to understand it better. So here, this sarva is a visheshana, is an adjective to dharman. So here it is said sarva dharman. So already there is plural. Dharman itself is plural. So when there is sarva, what purpose does it solve? That is, the purpose of sarva is to highlight that the prerequisites which are required for the particular upayam, they are also to be considered here. That is what is explained by Mamnigal. Now when engaging in such upayams, there are certain prerequisites such as sandhyahinaha ashuchihi nityam anarhaha sarva karmasu. So this is a very well known pramanam. One who has gone through Yajnopavidam, Brahmopadesham, one who has this Yajnopavidam, before engaging in any other karma, he must perform Sandhyavandanam. If he does not perform Sandhyavandanam, he is unqualified to engage in any other activity. That is what our elders used to say, even at our home. For example, we have to do Tiruvaradhanam. For that, even to fetch water, first we have to do Sandhyavandanam. To start, before starting anything, because some people we see that way, they go take bath and then they start many of the processes like preparing for food, gathering in, raw materials, whatever it is. They will gather all of that and then they will go and put Urdhva Pundram and then Sandhyavandanam and so on. And then by the time the rice will be cooking in the stove and so on, they will keep it so that they can save time. But Shastram says, Sandhyahinaha Ashuchihi. We are not clean. We are not qualified to do anything. Not even to fetch water from well or river or whatever, wherever we fetch the water from. Even that first step cannot be done without performing Sandhyavandanam. So we have to perform Sandhyavandanam, then only we can start everything else. So here the sarva is to include all of those prerequisites also. So whatever activities which give qualification for us to engage in our Nitya Karma, even those have to be considered as part of this sarva dharma. So he is going to say paritejya, that means we have to give up all of that. So whatever we have to be doing for our actual means which is to be performed, as well as the prerequisites for those means, everything should be considered. So here the yogyata, the qualification is given to us by Sandhyavandana, Panchamaha Yajna, all of those. So these Nitya Karmanushtanams. So these Nitya Karmanushtanams, they are included in the word sarva. So this sarva dharman means the upayams, the sadhanams, that is karma yogam, jnana yogam, bhakti yogam and so on. And for that karma yogam to be performed, we have to do sandhyavandanam. We have to do snanam before that. And then in this manner, whatever prerequisites from the time of waking up, whatever prerequisites are there, nothing will be excluded from this sarva dharman. Everything is included in the sarva dharman. So, that is 196th Sutram. Now, in the 197th Sutram, he is concluding whatever he has been saying so far. In this 197th Sutram, starting with Aga. Aga. Shruti Smriti Chotidangalai Nitya Naimitikadi Rupangalana Karma Yogadi Karma Yogadi Upayangalai Endrapadi. So, here, so far in Sarva Dharman, Pillalokacharya has explained, that is, the Sarva Dharman explains these particular aspects. What are those aspects? Whatever is highlighted by Shruti and Smriti, whatever the Nitya Naimitika Karma, and all the other Upayams, Karma Yogam, Jnana Yogam, Bhakti Yogam, and all of the other aspects which are prerequisites for all of them. So, all of these are collectively highlighted in the word Sarva Dharman. That is Mamnigal's commentary. So, here by the this Dharma word is elaborated by Shruti and Smriti. This whatever is included in Sarva Dharman is explained in Shruti and Smriti, and they are ordered in Shruti and Smriti. They can be in the form of Nitya Karma, Naimitika Karma and so on. Nitya Karma means whatever we do on daily manner, and Naimitika means whatever we do it, whatever we do occasionally. For example, Grahana Tarpanam, that is occasional Naimitika Kaikaryam, Naimitika Karma. So all of these, which are included in many of these yogams, such as Karma Yogam, Jnana Yogam, Bhakti Yogam, all of these are included in this Sarvadharman. So that is 197th Sutram. Now 198th Sutram, there is a question here. Manavan Mamnigal raises this question and he says Pillilokacharya is answering that question here in 198th Sutram. That is, now all of these upayams, they are all Swarupa Viruddham. That is, they are contrary to the nature of Jivatma. What is the nature of Jivatma? Paratantriyam. Paratantriyam means total subservience. When total subservience is the Swarupam, true nature of Jivatma, how can such totally dependent person individually pursue any of these activities? And if he is pursuing any of these activities which are having self-effort, how can they be said as dharma? That is the question here. Why are we saying, why is Bhagavan saying them as dharma? That is the question here. Because they should be said as adharma according to Bhagavan. Because what is dharma? Dharma means a particular process to reach Bhagavan. But these are not apt for the Jivatma. The Jivatma, being totally subservient person, cannot undertake any self-effort to achieve Bhagavan. Because that is contrary to a servant. A person is there who is serving another person. There is master and there is servant. If the servant needs something, he needs to go and ask the master, and the master has to give the particular thing instead of the servant trying to get it on his own. Similarly, if the servant tries to get it on his own, then it will be contrary to his nature. Similarly, Bhagavan is the master of all. We are all servitors to him. Now, if we want to attain Bhagavan, if we want to reach Bhagavan, if we do anything on our own, how can that be said as dharmam? That is the question here. It cannot be, that cannot be said as dharmam, because it is not apt for our nature. What is apt for our nature is can be said as dharmam. What is not apt for our nature, how can that be said as dharmam? That is the question. So here it is said that Bhagavan should have said sarva adharman parityajya. He should have said, you give up all the activities which are not apt for you, which are contrary to your nature, you give up all of them. That is what he should have said. But why did he say dharma? That is the question here. For that, Pillilokacharya is answering in 198th Sutram, இவற்றை தர்மம் என்கிறது பிரமித்த அர்ஜுனன் கருத்தாலே. So here, Bhagavan is saying these, he is naming them dharmam because Arjuna thinks them to be dharmam. That is why. So it is to relate to Arjuna, Bhagavan is using that term. Arjuna is thinking that karma yogam is my dharma, jnana yogam is my dharma, bhakti yogam is my dharma. He is thinking like that. So to explain to Arjuna, who is having such confusion, he is using the same term. For example, simple example is, we are giving some practical examples, laukika examples, but that may not be apt to explain something which is related to Vaidika. But why we are giving such examples? So that others who are reading or listening, they will understand if we give something relating to the individual's terminology. That is why our acharyas have given some examples in the Vyakhyanam. In the commentaries, they give examples so that we understand. It is not that they want to give a laukika example. They would want to only explain the concept. They would not even want to speak about laukika matters. But they give examples so that we understand. For example, a simple example will be, while talking about great love towards Bhagavan, in some places it is explained, just like how one has attachment towards wife or children, we should have attachment towards Bhagavan. When we really look into it, how can we compare attachment towards Bhagavan and attachment towards worldly people? that cannot be compared. But the example is given so that we understand, oh, just as we are attached to towards our wife and children and parents and so on, we have to be more attached to towards Bhagavan. So we understand. Similarly, here Bhagavan is using the term dharma so that Arjuna can understand it readily, because he has been thinking that all of these are dharma. He is thinking karma yogam is dharma, he is thinking jnana yogam is dharma. So to clarify, to relate to Arjuna, to make him understand, he is saying these to be dharmam. That is the simple meaning. So here Mamnigal is explaining that. So for the Jivatma's true nature, that is Bhagavad Atyanta Paratantriyam, for that desirable aspect, all of these activities, Karma Yogam, Jnana Yogam, Bhakti Yogam, Trinama Sankirtanam, Deshavasam, all of these being done as Upayam, they are contrary. So they should have been said as Adharma. But because Arjuna is considering that his own dharma, which is fight, he thinks that to be adharma. He thinks that his own fight here is adharma. This is not right, because I am offending, I am hurting my own relatives, my own gurus, my own brothers. I am hurting all of this. So this is not dharma. So he is thinking that to be adharma. And he thinks that all of these other aspects, I should just be engaged in meditating, I should be just giving up everything and leaving from here. So since he is thinking like that, since he is thinking that this is dharmam and fighting is adharmam, Bhagavan is using that term dharmam to relate to him. So that is the reason for saying sarvadharman. So with this, Mamnigal concludes that Pillalokacharya has explained the first term sarvadharman. So this is the first word in the first half of Charma Shlokam. For that, Pillalokacharya has given the explanation, says Manavarma Mamnigal. In the subsequent sutrams, he is going to talk about the next portions. So we'll see them in the next session. Okay, so we will see that in the next session. So, Alvar Emberumanar, G.R. Thiruvadigale Sharanam, G.R. Thiruvadigale Sharanam.
To learn such valuable information about our Sri Vaishnava Sampradaya, please download Koyil, K-O-Y-I-L app from Google Play Store or Apple App Store. Our website is koyil.org, K-O-Y-I-L.org.